Hey everybody, I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna talk a little bit about what goes into your fabrication notes and why you even need fabrication notes in the first place. Now, your fabrication notes basically tell the fabricator how they're going to fabricate your PCB. If you work at a manufacturer, you're probably gonna have your own format for fabrication notes. Generally, you receive an order, prep the notes, send it out to the line, and there it goes. It's off in the distance. If you're a designer and you don't know exactly where you're going to produce, or you want to be able to produce at multiple fabricators, you should prepare some fabrication notes that accurately communicate the intent of the design and how you want the board manufactured. So what we're going to look at today is what you need to put in your fabrication notes and what they mean. So let's get into it. So what we want to do now is actually look at some example fabrication notes, and what I'm going to do is just walk through each one of these reasonably quickly. Some of the stuff you might have to Google elsewhere, there's a couple of standards that are referenced, but generally you could take this and you could adapt it to your own project. A couple of things to note about this set of fabrication notes. I'm showing it here inside of a Google Doc, but you could take this and put it directly into, like, you know, a drawing that you produce in, let's say, like AutoCAD, or you could put it directly in your PCB layout. And actually, one thing that's really common is to actually take the PCB layout and turn the actual PCB layout into a fabrication drawing. And then you just put all those elements in the fabrication drawing in like a mechanical layer or something. That way, when you export your Gerbers, you're only exporting the important layers that are needed for fabrication. So that's your overlay layers, paste mask, copper layers, plane layers, any assembly, mechanical layers, things like that, drill drawings, stuff like that. So here I've got an example inside of Altium Designer where this is done. And so you'll notice here, we've got fabrication notes here in this one window. Here, if I go over to this area, you can see I've got a stack up table. So this lists all of the different materials that are in the stack up. And you'll notice this is a hybrid stack up. So I've got a Rogers laminate here on this top layer. And then the rest are all an Isola 370HR FR4 laminate. Looking over here, we've got a drill chart. And so this is generally what goes into a fabrication drawing. You can generate this stuff automatically in your CAD tools. And then you want to include fabrication notes. So let's walk through the different fabrication notes and see what's actually in here. So first note that I have on my notes, and before I continue, you can rewrite these. You don't have to have them in a specific order. There is a list of stuff you should include, but I've never seen any like standard or anything that says, you know, you must state this first, you must state this second, and so on and so forth. So the first fabrication note here in this document, fabricate per IPC 6012A Class 2. This is an important designation. Certain products under the IPC standard are very critical for, you might say, preserving human life. And there are different classes of IPC products, okay? So Class 1 is throwaway. Basically, use it once and it's done. Toss it in the garbage. Class 2 is kind of your everyday workhorse, long reliability type of product. So not meant for single use, not meant to be just used and thrown out. Then there's Class 3. Class 3 is ultra high reliability, where, again, you might say human life depends on its operation. So medical products, aerospace products, military products, I believe even automotive products could qualify as IPC Class 3 products. Now, different industries have their own standard of what might be considered high reliability. So just as an example, like within aerospace, one of the open standards groups is the open VPX standards. Open VPX has its own set of reliability criteria that actually go beyond IPC Class 3. And again, that's an aerospace product. They need high reliability. There are other examples in other industries. So that's a reliability class that's listed first. Then here, second note, they're just telling you what the board thickness is. They're saying refer to the stack up document, but here you can just see it right here on the stack up drawing in the actual fabrication drawing. This particular note is just telling you that the board has to comply with a certain solderability test. So if you really want to, you can go look up the JSTD003 solderability test. Here, you want to specify the surface finish. Most boards just going to be Enig. Enig is fine. Maybe it's Enipig. Here, this particular set of notes was copied over from a radar board, and so it's using immersion silver. Type of solder mask and color. Here, it's just written out with a bunch of X's. LPI is liquid photoimageable solder mask. Color, just ask your fabricator. This type of stuff, like with solder mask and here in note six, you know, the silk screen legend, that's normally something that you would specify when you're like filling out a quote form or something, or when you first email your fabricator and you're asking them, what the quote's going to be to fabricate the board. And they're probably going to ask you, what solder mask color you want? What silk screen color do you want? Stuff like this. You need to specify all of that. So putting that in your fabrication notes just allows you to just send this off and say, hey, all of the notes are in the document. They can read it. They'll be able to produce it and they'll know exactly what it is you want. You won't have to, keep filling out these forms or anything like that. You could also just copy this and put it into an email and send it to them if you really wanted to. On note seven, you can see here just minimum conductor width. So this is something where you might specify, like, this is what I need. And your fabricator is going to look at this and say, well, we can do this or we can't do this. It's going to tell them what process level they need to use. And then they'll ultimately help them quote the board for you. Next, via tenting. So tented vias mean they are just vias that are covered in solder mask. You need to specify whether it's one or both sides if they are going to be tented. If they're not going to be tented, you can just put the note, all vias are to be untented or non-tented. Here are the pads, or are the vias filled. If they are in a pad, so all vias on pad shall be filled with non-conductive epoxy. Again, just specifying whether they're filled or open vias. And here we have some tolerances. You always want to specify tolerances in fabrication notes. Again, this is going to let the manufacturer know this is what I want. The manufacturer can then come back to you and specify this is what we can do reliably, and that helps you make the decision as to whether or not you want to work with them. And then, of course, if you choose not to work with them, you can just send this off to someone else and decide, or try and find someone who can hit your tolerances. If your tolerances are too tight for everything, you may find that, unfortunately, some manufacturers may not be able to work with you because of tight tolerances. So they will give a board a non-bid status and you'll have to take it somewhere else, unfortunately. Next, on note 10, solder mask opening kept the same size as pad. 1-to-1 for all components. So they're just specifying, or this is just specifying how big of a solder mask opening do I need around the pad? Is the solder mask going to come over the edge of the pad a little bit? Is it going to be left open a little bit? This is the type of thing that you should define in your footprints or in your design rules. Your design rules can actually apply this for you when you're setting up your board and when you're setting up your project. So 11 is important. This is an environmental compliance issue. So here this is saying vendor should follow RoHS compliant process and lead free for manufacturing. So here you're just specifying, I want lead free soldering. I want all for lead free processing. Number 12. So this is, again, not necessarily a legal requirement, but this says that I care about traceability. So number 12, manufacturer's identification date code letter shall be silk screened on the solder side of the board. So essentially what you're saying is I want to be able to trace this throughout the supply chain, or I want to be able to allow someone else to trace this throughout the supply chain. And so they'll be able to see who manufactured the board. So you as the designer may not also be the manufacturer. If you are the designer and it's your company, you should definitely put your own company logo on the board just so that people know who designed it. But then the manufacturer will need to put some sort of marking on the board to show that, to show where it came from and who manufactured it. Number 13, trace widths and tolerances. Again, pretty straightforward. Number 14, just dimensionality, inches versus millimeters. That one should be obvious. So number 15, this is more something for the fabrication of the bare board. Here we've got bow and twist requirements, and this is just telling you how flat the board needs to be and how reliable that needs to be. Boards, when they are pressed or when they come off the press and they're during fabrication, they aren't perfectly flat, but they get pretty close. And so here, 0.7% is just a limitation that was specified in these notes based specifically on what the manufacturer was able to do. And then here, there's just a testing method that you specify. IPC TM650 is, kind of a basic testing standard that's used for most products. Next, material requirements. So here, when I first started doing PCBs, I didn't know what this UL94V-0 was. This is actually the flammability rating for a material that qualifies as an FR4 grade material. Here, you're specifying that the board is going to contain a registration marking on the silk screen. Manufacturers that do like UL testing or that do any kind of flammability testing, they're going to be the ones that want to certify that. You as the designer, you probably shouldn't certify that, you know, falsify it if you haven't actually done the test. And I will say that about many testings, not just like flammability tests, but like signal integrity tests or anything like that. Don't certify it or claim to certify it if you can't actually prove it. Here in part B, this is the glass transition temperature. So TG, here there's a bunch of X's, you just fill in the number that you want, or equivalent. So this is actually important for material selection. And so when we did an earlier video on material selection, we talked a little bit about candidate substitute materials. Not all materials are perfectly the same, but you can usually get pretty close. So maybe you go into a fab run and you specify a specific laminate from a specific vendor. If that particular fabricator doesn't stock it, they might stock something that is an equivalent substitute. And so this is one of those points where you're specifying, hey, this is a must have. I must have this particular glass transition temperature or equivalent. And then of course, equivalent material, you want it to be RoHS compliant, halogen free, so on and so forth. Here, approved by ABC Corp. ABC Corp is you, the designer. So what you're basically telling them is, I'm okay with an equivalent, but I want to approve it first. Here, layer to layer registration. So this is telling the fabricator how close you need to have the lateral alignment between layers during when they're building the stack up. Okay, so when they are pressing layers into the complete layer stack during fabrication, there can be some very slight lateral misregistration. And so what that means is that things can be just slightly off a little bit. Here, this is just specifying a tolerance that you will accept from the fabricator. And so this is one of those things that the fabricator then has to look at and tell you, yes, we can reliably do that with high yield, or no, we can't do it, here's why, or they'll just give you no bid and tell you to go somewhere else. Here, 18 is interesting because this illustrates an example of being able to say, I need this particular fab note for this specific reference designator. You can apply these types of notes specifically to different reference designators and put them into your fabrication notes, so that way it's very clear what you want to see on the board. 19. So 19, this is a good way to specify what you want for impedance. And this particular example is meant to illustrate that some fabricators, not all, but some, will have enough diversity of material stocks that you can just specify and say, hey, I want to have this width on this layer, or this trace width on this layer, hit this impedance, and this is the stack up I want. And they will be able to mix and match a set of materials to help you get within a certain tolerance. And so you'll notice here in this note 19, I've specified a tolerance here, okay? So we've got three subnotes to 19. This is just single-ended traces, and then two notes for differential pairs on different layers. You can just keep adding this up until you get to, you know, all the different layers that are gonna have impedance-controlled traces. Generally, you are not going to just tell the fabricator, like, this is what I want for impedance. Generally, what you might do is go in with a proposed stack up that you already know will hit a target impedance with a certain width. And they will tell you, yes, we can get to that, no, we can't. If they give you the alternative, you then have to check and make sure that this is gonna fit within your impedance tolerances. And that's usually a back and forth conversation. It's fine to have that conversation because ideally, they should help you with that because, let's face it, they want your business, they want you to come back and produce again with them. Here on note D, you're basically just saying, hey, it's okay to adjust the geometries by a certain amount. And this is just for an impedance target. If your board doesn't have any impedance control requirements or you don't have any impedance controlled routing, maybe you're just using SPI and I2C or something like this for digital, don't worry about note 19. All right, everybody, so hopefully this helps illustrate what you should put in your fabrication notes if you want to produce your board at multiple different fabricators. Now, you should always send in your stack up at the beginning just to make sure that they can fabricate it or they can get reasonably close within your specified tolerances. And so we saw those tolerances specified in the fabrication document in the fabrication notes. So that's all important information, especially if you ever want to take your project and actually scale it up into a high volume product. If you want a copy of the fabrication notes that I showed in our example, there's going to be a link in the description. You can go get that copy copy, copy it into your own documentation, and use it however you want. Feel free to modify it, do whatever you want with it. Hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, go download Circuit Maker. Super easy to use, super easy to start laying out a board and preparing manufacturing files, and then eventually you'll be ready to move on to a more advanced program like Altium Designer. Thanks everybody, and definitely don't forget to call your fabricator on this one.